Hello everybody, good evening. I'm Cosmic Claire, and welcome to another one of my evening video blogs, in which I usually talk about things from different kind of angles from what you'll mainly hear about on the media and on the internet. Well, this evening I want to comment on something that, well, it's happened a day or two ago now. Obviously, we've all seen the news of the passing away of Margaret Thatcher, who was Prime Minister of Britain in the 1980s. And I've been very interested by the diversity, shall we say, of the comment that has been passed. And we go all the way from the hagiography, I think it is, and the worship of certain portions of our society, and to almost equally balanced on the other side by the those who cannot have a good word to say for her. And obviously all of us who lived through the 1980s were indelibly marked by the experience, and I think I've already mentioned in a previous blog the night when she was elected, and after having stayed up until dawn with my friends next at the flat next door, drinking Southern Comfort and not getting much, we went out and walked the top of King Alfred's Castle nearby where we lived, and saw the whole of Leeds 6, at least as much as we could see of it, covered in a thin layer of snow, which was kind of a bit like reminiscent of the White Witch of Narnia. But anyway, that's all a long time ago, and obviously we've all been changed by that experience, and now she's gone. And I think the main thing I wanted to say about this was that I feel it is really there seems to be a certain response that some people have had, which is to want to dance on her grave, and this apparently the Judy Garland song is going to be released and all that. And I think my own response to this is that I feel this is a misapplication of our energies, because while it's not, there's nothing wrong in critiquing her, shall we say, contribution to the history of this realm. There's a kind of point beyond which it goes beyond rational critique into negative attachment, I suppose they would say in Buddhism, and rather than gloating and celebrating and putting a lot of energy into a particular type of frequency, which is about revenge and getting even, I think this is the ideal opportunity to let that go. She was a particular archetype of the old Aeon, and she played her role at the awakening, as some people would say. I think that it's much more important to put our minds and our attention into trying to achieve a higher vibration of consciousness, which should actually be easier now that, you know, people who were kind of, you know, giving energy to the old morphic field are leaving us. So we should leave them. And I've been thinking a lot more, and I've been seeing items on the web about the importance of what's becoming known as a quantum consciousness. Because what this is about is the fact that we're moving from a paradigm where we saw the world as mechanical up until the early 20th century. Newtonian mechanics had ruled for 200 and odd years, and it was seen as a rigid fixed system which had preceded the mythopoeic theological view of the universe from the Middle Ages, which had again in its own time had succeeded the heroic mythologies and belief systems of the past. So now we're moving, well, we have for nearly a century been aware of the quantum world and the fact that the world is made up of this strange synchronous bubbling chaos that is the quantum world. And up until, well, I think we're just, I suppose this thought has been around for a while, but it's only in the last few years that I've been reading stuff which kind of makes sense of putting the two levels of reality together. Because on the surface level, we live in a universe which is described by Newton's laws. It's very predictable and mechanical, and we can handle that, because that, although in the previous ages, the Middle Ages, the ancient times, they didn't fully understand the nature of, you know, F equals ma, or the acceleration of due to gravity, or all these kinds of things that Newton explained and mathematically quantified. Nonetheless, they didn't have a understanding of the substrate of matter, which began to be expounded upon by Max Planck in the early part of the 20th century. And for quite a long time, we've just been in this space where people have just said, well, yeah, the quantum universe at the you know, lower than the nano level is just so weird, we can't possibly understand it, and we can only really, you know, get our human mind to grips with this intermediate and macroscopic level where things operate on the Newtonian mechanical level. But of course, then you go on to the higher levels, the super macro level, and then, you know, Einsteinian relativity comes in. Things slow down, speed up, and at the bottom end, of course, we have this quantum soup, this strange synchronous thing where everything is part of everything else, and particles can exist at the same time in different parts of the universe. They can communicate across billions of light years. Wormholes can exist from one place to another. It's completely bizarre. But it is the world of it is the stuff of which we are made. So we are that. It's not like some other thing out there. Oh yeah, well, you know, look out the window, it's a bit of quantum soup. You know, oh, in here, in my living room, it's just strict Newtonian mechanical laws. We don't mess with any of that weird stuff. But of course, it's not like that. It's not like a separation reality where You know, you might say, oh, well, there's me and there's the rest of the universe, and we don't operate on the same laws. You know, we are all part of that quantum soup, and we are all coexisting as part of that one unified whole. This is what is meant by unity consciousness. That you get the naysayers who say, oh, unity consciousness, yeah, it's just another kind of form of communism, new world order, oppression, obedience, slavery, blah, 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 blah. And it's not that at all. What it is really about is realizing that we are all like the quantum particles in this quantum soup, which are all interdependent. They're all different. Or at least at the quantum level, I mean, you just have these kind of vast numbers of different types of particles which break and fragment and reform and everything, and, like, you know, humans and their associations and their relationships. And so that's what's happening at our level. And, you know, this thing about wormholes and quantum entanglement and synchronicity, this is where synchronicity comes into our lives. We have, of course, the excellent work by Roger Penrose and Stuart Hameroff, I believe his name is, looking at the way that consciousness looks like it might be a kind of doorway to the infinite, which manifests through these quantum tubule concentrations in neurons, which kind of turn off when people have anesthetics, apparently, as I understand what Stuart Hameroff is saying. And they come back on when we wake up. So it's like, hey, what's going on here? You know, quantum activity is consciousness. Ah, this is getting a bit crazy, isn't it? Or at least it's intimately involved in what we understand as consciousness, and in more than a mechanical way, or even the way that you might say electricity turns a light bulb on. And so this is leading into the whole quantum consciousness conceptual movement. I don't know if it's a movement as such, I think, but a lot of people are kind of exploring this idea. Because to look at it in very mundane terms, surely being able to have instantaneous response to the universe must have some kind of evolutionary advantage and some sort of evolutionary edge, when the rest of the world are responding in a kind of like real-time, slow-motion, mechanical response kind of way. Which is an interesting thing, because I've had experiences whereby the universe has put me in the right place at the right time, whereby if I hadn't been there, things might have happened that would have been undesirable. So it wasn't like I found a situation and I thought, oh, crumbs, I've got to deal with this situation, it's getting out of control. But there was a situation about 20 years ago when the universe kind of parachuted me into a situation. I was all kind of comfortably enjoying this situation, and then this kind of predator situation from an outsider came along, but they'd obviously been planning this for a while, and the universe just spontaneous'd me into the situation, so I was able to be part of it. Wasn't just me, there were several other people who were also had the same experience, and we were all put in place, and we were just ready and waiting, completely unbeknownst to ourselves, to be able to respond to this situation and have benign, fruitful outcome, which fortunately we did, and we repelled the Predator, and they were quite surprised, I think. And I think this is the way that we need to be thinking in terms of defeating this monster which is trying to take over the world. And so this is coming back to the kind of Margaret Thatcher thing. If we're so busy caught up in getting revenge, which is or expressing negative energies about offloading all our hatred and resentment to somebody who's dead and gone and apparently was suffering from dementia for the last period of time in her life anyway, well, if you do that, then you're going to clog up your quantum vibrations, I'm inclined to think. So it's really important to be able to let go of the past, not get caught in habitual patterns, because that is the way back into mechanical causality. Those who've watched me previously will know that I've talked about Rupert Sheldrake, and this is a doorway into his world. And I'm completely astonished. I always remember one of the first things I ever watched on YouTube about 4 years ago was Richard Dawkins saying that the universe is not only stranger than we imagine, as we're always finding out by new discoveries, but that it will always be stranger than we can imagine. And I think that it's very sad that Richard Dawkins seems to have gone back kind of into a more rigid, prescriptive kind of notion of science, but I'll leave that behind. He has his own path to follow. So I think that this whole notion of the quantum universe that we are gradually becoming aware of, it will transform our not only our understanding of it, but the way that we relate and the way that we interact in the world, and the way that we overcome obstacles and difficulties. The universe will show that it is a genuinely connected consciousness of which we are all parts, working out these problems. And I was listening to something earlier today whereby it was being talked about how it's really, really important to be able to, whilst knowing the opposition, understanding the opposition and knowing the difficulties which those people who put themselves in opposition and attempt to dominate, to understand what they are like, but at the same time to allow that they are part of the universe and to allow them the possibility of also changing and adapting or letting go of the past, because we've all been stuck in situations sometimes, and often I'm talking about situations of our own conceptual habits which can limit us, but actually the universe is a living, vibrant consciousness underneath it all, which is creating all this. And if we can allow ourselves to let go, it can work through us, and wonderful things can happen, because we're in this connected wholeness of this quantum universe, like a giant universal brain. You know, don't hang on to the past, folks. Don't hang on to resentment. Think about how you can project forward into a positive state of consciousness, which can create, which can connect with this universal consciousness. Find that still vibe within. That's the really core place. Don't get caught up in those external stress vibes. Find the stillness within, and we can connect with that quantum consciousness. Okay, thank you very much for watching this evening, folks. I hope you found something to take away with you and think about. So I'll say good evening, thank you, and in La Cache.